What is going on, guys, and welcome back to another video. Today we're going to be taking a look at the newly released Explorer's Guide to Wildemount, written by Matthew Mercer and published by Wizards of the Coast. This is a new campaign setting for 5th edition, which for those who follow Critical Role will be quite familiar with the Wildemount setting from Campaign 2. The first thing that strikes me is how thick this book is. There's a lot of information in here and a lot of stuff to cover, so I'm going to do my best in this short video to do just that. The first thing we open it up to is the content page, and naturally the content page is just the first place you want to look at if you're going to look at a gazetteer, and the gazetteer section of this book is huge. Turning the page, we actually are introduced to a quick message by Matthew Mercer, as well as a welcome to Wildemount section, which just includes the basic information you would need to run an adventure in this campaign setting. Chapter 1 then introduces us to the story of Wildemount, which is filled with quite a lot of flavour in regards to the history, the organisations, and some of the past events of this campaign setting. This reminds me quite a lot of the Sword Coast Adventurer's Guide, if you guys have read that book. Next up, we are sort of quickly thrust through the history section, straight into the pantheon of this land, the main deities of this world, so to speak, which is a general useful section if you are running a highly religious campaign. But for a lot of people, I think this is going to be a section that you're going to skip over, straight to the organizations that are prevalent within this land. You can see we have the Kryn dynasty here and some information regards to them. Now, this whole section reminds me a lot of the Guildmaster's Guide to Ravnica, which focuses a lot on the guilds that run the city and their goals. You can see we have the Boros Legion here as an example of that. And you can see on the right-hand side of this page here, we actually have the goals of the Kryn dynasty, along with some figures of interest within this organization. And this feature is actually prevalent for every single organization in the book. They have all this information repeated for all of them. So we're going to move straight into Chapter 3 now, which is to do with the Wildemount Gazetteer. And the Wildemount Gazetteer is kind of set up in a very similar way to the Tal Dorei campaign setting. And as you can see, it has sort of information below a picture of a zoomed in section on the map. Now, the actual map itself for this campaign setting for Wildemount is huge. I can't actually fit the entire thing onto the frame to show you guys, but it is in quite a lot of detail. It's very detailed. It's lovely. It is only one-sided, but it's still a fantastic map, and I'm a big fan. Now, for each section in this gazetteer, and it is a thick gazetteer, I think it's over 100 pages, we have information on the population, the defences, the commerce, and we also have information on the adventures that you might have within it. You see we've got examples of high and low adventures. And again, this is something that has been repeated from the Tal Dorei campaign setting, where we have information on possible adventures in the different locations mentioned in the book. It's also something that reminds me of the Eberron Rising from the Last War, where we actually have information on the location, then interesting things about the location, and then potential characters and figureheads of those different locations. Now, you can basically turn to any page of the gazetteer and find really useful information regarding the location, but also possible adventures. And this tells me one thing in particular. This tells me that exploration is key when Matt was writing this. I love these little mini adventures were included in the different locations. They sort of give you some idea of what to do when the players go there. Completely different from the Sword Coast Adventurer's Guide, where Waterdeep is given such a little amount of time and little description, and all of the description it's given is flavour. Now, this is totally different from the Wildemount campaign guide, because the Wildemount campaign guide gives you not only useful information when running a town or a city or just an interesting place, but it also gives you potential adventures. And that just means that your players will always have something to do wherever they go, even if you, the DM, have no idea what you should throw at them at that point. So Chapter 4 moves into the character options, and this isn't a new section of campaign guides. This is one that we kind of have come to expect. What is useful is that we have these races in the regions of the Wildemount campaign setting. So, for example, we have how they fit in with the campaign setting in general, which is only a small section, but is quite useful in terms of placing a character or that kind of thing. We are also given some information on sort of some additional kind of race options. Like, for example, we've got the hollowed one here. Kind of some more subclasses in regards to the fighter and in regards to the wizard as well. So those are two useful things. We also have some new spells coming into the game with a whole new school of spells in terms of Dunamancy, which is like time magic. And there are some useful and fun little options here for your spellcasters. I'll zoom into one just there so you guys can see in a little bit more detail. Chapter 5 is all dedicated to the adventures of Wildemount. Now there are actually four sections here, four adventures given in the book, as you can see right here. And this reminds me of the Ravnica campaign guide, where we actually had an adventure given to us in the campaign guide itself. Now, instead of just having one adventure with the Wildemount campaign setting, we are given the four. And these four are kind of what you'd expect. They are great starting adventures, the ones you could throw in at any point. They have their own stat blocks, their own player handouts. They are quite well fleshed out and have quite an interesting story. I don't think they're anything amazing, but I think they're great and a fantastic addition. Chapter 6 is dedicated to the Wildemount treasures. You can see we have just some useful items in here, just some general sort of artifacts and sort of possessions, some of which you'll recognize from the campaign. But what we also have is a return of these items here, which have sort of like awakened and exalted properties, which we first saw in the Tal'Darae campaign setting book. So I'm really glad to see these making a return and a sort of consistency coming from this section. The final chapter is, of course, the bestiary, which is what we've grown to love from these kind of books. And it's not actually a big section, it's actually quite minor. There are some interesting stuff in here. We've got the frost worm, which is kind of almost like a take on the purple worm, a frost giant zombie, gloom stalkers, some useful stuff, but this is not a large section of the book by any feat. This is actually probably the smallest section. So if you're looking for new monsters, this is not the book for you. Well, guys, thank you so much for watching this video and taking the time out of your day to spend just a few minutes with me. I hope this video has helped you. If you've liked this video, consider clicking that like button or the subscribe button. I really appreciate it. I'm so happy to be bringing you this content. Hopefully, I'll see you in the next one.